Complete off this year, or finish up this year, first semester. But today is on STEM and dentistry, a one's perspective. Let me get things started. Okay, session one, woman in STEM, a brief history. So STEM, as many of y'all are probably familiar, stands for science, technology, engineering, mathematics. Pretty basic. It was coined in 2001 by Judith Ramling, the then acting director of the U.S. National Science Foundation's Education and Human Resource Division. Basically, she was involved in education. It was originally intended to inform like curriculums in schooling, so it's the reason we have so many like robotics and you know, like science Olympiad type stuff in our schools nowadays. It is important to note that while the term STEM itself is, you know, of course, a contemporary term from the 2000s, most like, you know, its components, you know, the science, technology, engineering, mathematics, those date back to the 18th century. So STEM in the past. In the past, 1800s to 1970s, STEM fields have typically been widely dominated, with some exceptions, particularly in nursing and teaching. Those were typically women focused sessions. Contributions by women who were in STEM positions were often underreported, some of which are actually still being undercovered today. Not going to focus too much on those, but if you are interested in learning about those contributions still being undercovered, you can look at Lost Women of Science Initiative. It's a nonprofit organization doing archival research about underreported contributions. There's our QR code right there if you have any interest. I'll move on. So women in STEM nowadays, so here's some statistics. Women make up 52.8% of science majors, of science major undergraduates in the United States today. However, when we look at women in STEM workforce, we see a major drop to only 28% of people in STEM workforce actually being women. So very big difference there, almost, you know, a huge difference, almost 20%. Most of women who are in the STEM workforce are clustered around the physical sciences, so that's like your chemistry, biology, and as well as mathematics. So 37 to 39% of people in the workforce are women. With computing and engineering having an even larger disparity at around 19% on both positions. So people started attributing this to what's called the leaky pipe phenomenon, in which women are statistically more likely than men to drop out of STEM at any point in their careers. This explains sort of why, as we go further up the STEM ladder, we see fewer for women. STEM ladder being, you know, you have your grade school education, college, graduate school, your later career, and moving up in careers to like upper management positions, and even further, I guess, you could say CEOs. We just see an overall decrease of women as we head up that ladder. So the question is, you know, why is this happening? Why do we see, you know, a mass exodus as we move up this ladder? And there's not really one good answer for this phenomenon. There's actually, it's been a pretty heavy study. So currently, there are two overarching kind of schools of thought that they believe what contributes to the leaky pipeline phenomenon. Those being societal and psychological contributions. So societal contributions basically are things like discrimination. That happens a lot in interviews. Women being passed up for promotions. Those are heavily discouraging, and often you see retention problems there. Stereotyping. That is another issue, typically in hiring practices. You'll see issues there. Lack of support, mentorships, and counseling. Counseling more towards you know, the educational side of things on that track. Mentorships being once women enter the workplace, not having already in place female leaders who are able to sort of take them under the wing, guide them through the process of navigating the workplace, that sort of thing. And harassment is also a major issue that has been found, especially in the medical workplace. A 1993 study actually found that 3/4 of female students reported some sort of harassment during their schooling. Which is awful. Moving on, we have psychological reasons. So there have been research reports that have cited lack of interest in women, but a lot of people actually attribute that to childhood experiences that are mainly influenced by societal norms. The idea being that the reason you see a lack of interest among STEM a lack of interest in STEM for women is because basically the way they're raised and the things they were introduced to as children or the things they were discouraged from. Also, a lack of confidence in the interest in studies, and that stems from implicit bias in teachers during formative years. So basically, they found that teachers were more likely to dissuade women from pursuing certain areas, not necessarily they're telling you, no, you can't do this, more just, I don't think this is right for you, or maybe you're just not a bad person. But really subtle comments like that, but they're all recorded, and it's definitely contributed to the lack. So we asked the question, you know, how do we fix this thing? It's very apparent, it's well documented. And so when we ended up doing our interview with Dr. Rivero, we were asking these questions. So I'm going to turn this over to John right now. He's going to introduce Dr. Rivero and her work.
All right. So introducing Dr. Rivero. So this is Dr. Pamela Rivero. She is from Brazil, and she currently is in the United States working at UNC. And she has a PhD in science focusing on microbiology and immunology. But her main focus being of the microbiome in the oral cavity is impact on children and adults. And she actually has 32 years in dentistry starting in 1991. So she's a very well pioneer. And starting with her education, she got her doctor of dental surgery from Fluminense Federal University in 1995. And then she got her certificate in pediatric dentistry in the Rio de Janeiro Federal University in 1997. And with the same university, she got her Master of Science in pediatric dentistry. And finally, she got her PhD in science, specifically in microbiology, in 2006. And currently, she works at the Adams School of Dentistry, also the ASOD. And she works at the Division of Diagnostic Sciences in 2018. And she continued her research and mentoring students in her research projects. And her research goals include the evaluation of the microbiome in association to oral diseases, such as like different microorganisms, such as fungi, viruses, and bacteria in the mouth, and see how that contributes to like oral decay and stuff like that. Also about clinical caries diagnosis, detection, prevention, treatment. And so she goes to the clinic and talks to patients about their problems and see how she can use her foundational knowledge and connect that to clinical sciences. Also, the oral health promotion in children and with systematic diseases. As I said before, she's a pediatric dentist, and so she focuses a lot on children and on their oral health problems. And finally, she investigates the virulent factors associated to these infections. And so things like diet, gender, and region, and just factors like those, and see how this affects oral diseases in the health. And here are some publications, our propaganda ones. I won't go into much detail, but I want to go, I'll talk a bit about the last two. And so the last two are the relationship between biofilm carries activity in gingivitis and HIV-positive children, and the oral health of HIV-infected Brazilian children. And this is why this is important, because her master thesis was actually implementing HIV with oral diagnosis. And on the previous slide, talking about her research projects, HIV is contributes to like a virulent factor. And I think what's interesting is Dr. Rivero is actually my mentor, so I research with her. And right now, we're working on our Hispanic Oral Health and Prevention Education Project, and we basically take clinical samples from the Hispanic population and find factors such as diet and access to resources to see if those contribute to oral diseases. And if you're interested in her, you can find her more of her publications on Google Scholar. And moving on to her story and the interview that we conducted with her with me and Felice.
Okay, so hi, my name is Felice Strong. And we can start off with North Carolina, where she visited from 2014 to 2015. She was a visiting scholar here at the Adams School of Dentistry. And then during that time, she was also a tenured professor. She came back in 2018 and she began a career as a director of neurology and oral microbiology. This is just a timeline, but in a more visual sense. So she started school in 1995 and continued her education all the way to 2006, where she finished with a doctorate degree in microbiology. And then she began as a professor in 2007, and she was also tenured all throughout. And then in 2018, she came to UNC to start the rest of her career as a research associate, professor, and postdoctorate director and director of microbiology and periology. So throughout our part of the presentation, we'll focus on three main points. One being woman in STEM, and then she from Dr. Rivera's perspective. And she does have a unique one, since she can speak about being a woman in STEM, but also an immigrant woman in the US. Then we'll talk about dentistry in Brazil versus in the United States, and how coursework is like there, and kind of the social norms. And then we'll talk about what we can do now and what the current state of women in STEM is, and how we can combat those barriers. Okay, so from her perspective, she is a first generation student. Her parents owned a farm and took care of it, and that's where she grew up. She continued her education all throughout in Brazil, and in Brazil, to learn like English, it's a completely separate coursework, unlike it is here in the US, where you usually learn a second language in your elementary school years and you continue all throughout high school. So aside from her main coursework, she'd have to go after school and just study English. So for university admissions, it's a very different process in Brazil, in the sense that you are usually solely accepted off of merit, at least it was when she was applying. And for the public schools there that are funded by the federal government, they're completely free if you're able to be accepted. So the admission process starts with like the 4-day testing process. Two of those days are focused on all the subjects you learn in high school, and then the rest are focused on the specific course you want to pursue in college. So she had to go through university admissions, and she was accepted into a federal public university where she was where she got her tuition taken care of. And then we'll dabble on the social cultural norms, which she had experienced when she had originally wanted to come to the US. She was fairly supported in her college years and pursuing a dental degree. However, when she wanted to come here to the US, specifically UNC, to pursue becoming a visiting scholar, her family was not as supportive as usually, I would say, like ours could have been, since in Brazil and many places around the world right now, the norm is that women are at home and they're more domestic, the sense that like they can't really take care of themselves or be independent outside of their family. So she had to buy her own ticket and she came to the US. She stood her foot, like she stood her ground, right? She stood her ground and she came here and she ended up loving it. So she came back after her tenure ended in 2018. But this is seen throughout, and another butterfly effect that can be seen from this is that since they're not encouraged, they have lower self-esteem and they won't pursue higher leadership positions. And usually a stereotype that surrounds this is that, oh, the retention rate isn't that high because she needs to, like women tend to go off, take care of family. And even if those said women don't take like gap years to raise families, they're usually juggling domestic housework and professional work at the same time, which doesn't allow for 100% like concentration in the field that you know they're pursuing. And then we'll talk a little about her transition to the US. It was more like she didn't have necessarily a very strong language barrier because she did learn English in Brazil, but it was more like culturally like the sayings or even just like the metric system that we have completely different from the rest of the world. The insecurity to like speak up because if you don't know if you're completely right or you don't want to say something and have other people judge you. Those are just some hard transitions to the US. So dentistry in Brazil. Contrary to popular belief, we would think that the statistic around 30 years ago is that it was a more male-dominant workforce, but actually 30 years ago, it was half and half. So this was around the time or a little bit before the time that she started pursuing her dental degree, and it was half and half in the medical field. However, in the U.S., it is still kind of, not kind of, it is still demonstrated as a male dominated. So, like we said before, public schools in Brazil were extremely prestigious. So, the select few that were accepted into the university, it was completely paid for. And in her different class, she said that there were actually 16%, not 16%, 16 women and 4 men, which is 20 in total. So, although we see this statistic, and referring back to what Ethan said, that although the demographic in the graduating classes is usually split 50-50, or even like you see here, 75% women, when it comes to PhD level education, academia, and leadership positions, women are seen far less prevalent, which is an issue we'll talk about later on as well. So what are the social aspects that come with this? There are two that we're focusing on right now, which are like the traditional roles, where after you settle down and you have a family, women, like for example, in my family, like my mom would stay at home and take care of the kids, but she was also working simultaneously. So men are more encouraged to pursue higher education because they have the time to. They aren't necessarily worrying about picking up the kids from preschool. They're at a job and they're providing for your family, this also leads to disproportionate salaries, because we can see that men are more likely to climb in the ranks, while women usually tend to stay at the starting salary, or there isn't much growth projection in that field. Then we see that there are lower retention rates as they need to fulfill their domestic roles. Then we have the double standards that take place. Women are often led with less confidence due to the stereotypes that will label them as aggressive, or they're more hyper-conscious about what they're wearing just because they're scared that they'll face judgment from their peers. They're, like we said, hyper-aware of their mannerisms and the way they're perceived. Dr. Rivera actually touched on this, how she was able to see women who feel be much more quiet because they're scared of judgment. Well, we could say that the men were more assertive and more aggressive, but they weren't perceived as aggressive. And also another important point is that women usually only apply for jobs that they fill all the requirements for, versus in when Dr. Rivera, in her field, she said that like men are more likely to apply for fields that are jobs that they don't necessarily know that they can fill all the requirements for, but they have the mentality that they can just learn as they go.
And so now we asked Dr. Rivera what we can do, or what she thinks that everyone in society should do to help alleviate this problem. And the first one is generational change. So from her perspective, immigrants have a typically like a more less active voice when talking about injustice compared to our current generation. And so demonstrating, or just trying to advocate and empower immigrants and just people who are in these disproportionate communities to say that they have a voice in this injustice is important, and having change within the workforce. Another thing is representation, not necessarily representation for women, but representation of men in meetings to talk about diversity in the workplace. And this is important because if you have a meeting and talk about diversity and it's not about the opposing side, then no change is gonna happen. You're just gonna have a regular meeting talking about change that you want to happen, but you can't happen. Another thing is to focus on skills and not identity. And identity regards to who they are biologically are, such as like if you're a woman, that shouldn't put you below another a tier list in that sense, but focus on merit and kind of how they're qualified for a position. Another thing is compensation, and this is to realize disparities between academia and the workplace and provide compensation for that. This means it's looking at places that needs more support, either financially or just society needs more support, and recognizing that. Also, building skills, and so one thing that Dr. Rivera touched on is having leadership and course training on for skills to be more competitive in the workplace. And another thing is talking about how women typically do not pursue higher positions such as deans and just like principal investigators because they believe that they didn't have the skills to do so, and this is something that Felice touched on. And so providing workshops to enhance these skills gives them more confidence to empower them to pursue higher positions. And finally is to have strategic development. And this goes along with focusing on goals for the future and see on terms of representation, and not only on gender, but also other factors such as race and sexuality to have a more diverse workplace and environment to study. And so some final remarks from us. And so we have a poll everywhere that we would like everyone to join if possible. And the winner, it's just some quiz questions, but the winner gets a prize bag, so.
Jonathan, it's JONATHANDINH 721.
Is it working?
Well, we didn't even talk about
that. Yeah,
was it?
Yeah.
This is a select all of the above. A select, you know, like, as I'm aware of myself, it's like.
Honestly, discuss.
Yeah. So the answer was for husband and daughter. Next one is, what are some ways to improve on the diversity in STEM / academia? It's actually all of the above, so yeah, not bad. Next question is, what is Dr. Rivero's favorite tea? These are questions you ask her, so that's what I like. Get her degree in dentistry. mention a research project that I'm working on with Dr. Rivero. What is that research project about?
First thing about it's a
HIV.
There's a big component about it.
Yeah.
I saw that guy.
Teeth.
What?
Teeth.
Okay. And?
That's all I got.
Isn't the analyzing team for HIV something is it for Hispanic population?
Yes.
Okay. Oh my God.
Turn the camera around. Love Dr. Hammer, so many of your students.
Thank you for coming to the conversation, and thank you to Dr. Rivero for her contributions to this.
If anyone wants to see the interview that we did with her, QR code's up on the board, just in case you're curious.
Yeah. But thank you.
Thank you so much, though.
Thanks.